Thank you.
Go.
Okay. So I guess in the early 90s, we did away with all our reel-to-reels. We had four tracks and stuff. And we went to video totally, and I sold off the reel-to-reels. And then I was working for the University of Texas doing media work. Wasn't really challenged time-wise, so I started looking around. I found out I was doing internet stuff for them, that there was nothing on the internet about reel-to-reel tape recorders. So I started a website called Reel-to-Reel Texas, just documenting things so people would have the information available. And I told my wife, we'd seen that Edison in the other room, and I said, you know, man, it'd be really fun for me to recoup the tape recorders I'd had when I was little, when I was using them. So she said, fine. So I started pulling some things from eBay, and we got, I think there was 13 or 14 I'd used, and it was a pretty cool collection. And then we got a Roberts upstairs that was a big self-reversing four-track reel-to-reel that looked great, heavy, but you could flip the heads up, and it had a black and white recorder in the middle. It had a rotating head in the middle. You could reconfigure the tape and play back video. And it happened like during the moon landing, so they said if you had that, you could have recorded that. And it was really cool because that suddenly made the collection a little bit more significant because it was really an unusual thing. So we started looking for unusual things, first things. Never thought I would see one of these when it came up on eBay. And it went by once for $500 and nobody bought it. And I just went, I don't believe this. So I told Chris, I'm getting it. And so I went out to Salinas. It was in Salinas, California. This De La Garca must have had 20 incredibly high-end recorders from Stevens to MCI to Studer and the Ampex. So we loaded this in the back of a Murano, and I noticed that he had this portable, which was the next generation from the 200. This was a 350 or 300. And I said, so what do you want for it? And he said, maybe 10 times what you got for the 200. And I said, no, I can't do that. So I'm finishing up saying, thank you very much, Mark. I do appreciate it. And he said, you know what, Martin? These two recorders have been together their whole life. You can have it for another 500. And I went, yes. And so we started loading it, and it, we've got a redone amplifier on here, actually. This is not the original 300 amplifier, but we do have a totally reconditioned 300 amplifier here, if I can ever get the time to work with these things. But this guy is really nice. I mean, they were just built like tanks, but again, this one was trying to be more portable than the other guy. And this one starts up and runs, but it needs some new capacitors on the motors to fire up and do the running. And again, this is just a matter of time. So as I started looking for new things, this was the first American-built tape recorder, which was the Brush Soundler BK-401. It actually runs by the heads backwards. And the neat thing, interesting thing about this is that this guy was built and advertised in the Saturday Evening Post, and then some dentist in Switzerland bought 50 of these to send over to Europe and have somebody rebuild them for the European market. And the only person he could find was Willie Studer, who was an electrician working on radios. And Willie Studer started working on these to refurbish them, and he said, it's not possible. He said, these are not going to last. They're just not made that well. I can do better. So he built this thing, which is the Studer Dynavox. This is a T26, the very first thing built by Willie Studer. This came from France. And we've got conversion power things, so we can play some of these things. I don't have it here. But I just thought that was amazing that this went to this and then turned into Revox Studer, I mean, which turned out to be one of the biggest worldwide companies ever. So that became even more significant. And then we were trying to trace the beginnings of TAC, Tascam, and we came across this. And this is the recorder that is pictured in this 25-year anniversary of the Tokyo Electronic Acoustic Company, which is TAC. And I went, wow, so that's the same recorder. And it says it's the TD-102, which is one of their first ones. They actually made one more earlier one. And so I started looking for that and came across this. And this had been in Nashville, never taken out of the wood crate, never been turned on, absolutely brand new. But if you look at this, this is an absolute miniature of that 300. Wow. The whole thing, it's just built the same way. It just the Japanese just copied it totally. But so it just started making the whole collection more interesting. So I was going to go around and make a 45-minute video about all this stuff, and by the time I got through, it was a three-hour thing, and now it's a seven-hour, three-DVD set that we sell. In fact, we're selling like hotcakes right here before Christmas for some reason. But after we produced that, the guy on the end was the other big American company, which was the MagnaCord, which was less expensive in a lot of radio stations, in a lot of studios. And I sent a copy of the DVD to them, and David Boyer, who is the son of John Boyer, who was one of the founders of MagnaCord, said, "My dad is in his early 90s. He has Alzheimer's. He saw your clips about MagnaCord and about the company getting started, and he came to life like he'd always been. And we hadn't seen him like that for years. And he said, I cannot tell you how deeply thankful our whole family was to see him like that. And you will get all the archives from the MagnaCord and all the original equipment and everything to the museum, which is wonderful." And then John died later that year. So it was like, thank you for letting us do that. So that's Willie Studer's next thing where he really got serious about Reeboks. Let me go down here and turn this down. And I just love the design and all this stuff, all the coordination. That sounds great. Wonderful JBLs.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, and again, I love the design stuff that he did.
It's beautiful. Even if it didn't work.
Yeah.
It's such a beautiful design.
And it's hard to find the amp and tuner to go with it.
Now, that's an A77?
Yeah.
Yeah, they show up a lot on eBay.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's cool because it's got all kinds of inside controls. And
there's that famous cantata recording.
Right, right.
I just ordered that from Chad. Yeah.
Oh, cool. Wow.
Doug Sachs did a special edition.
I'm vaguely familiar with that. Not
vinyl.
Oh, wow.
Doug Sachs was the engineer in Santa Paula, Southern California.
Oh,
he passed away, but before he passed away, he arranged to sell his entire room, two cutting lathes, all the electronics, to Chad.
Oh, wow.
Because he didn't want it being, you know, piecemealed out or whatever.
Right.
So after he passed, they put it all in a truck, shipped it to Salina, Kansas.
Wow.
And they're going to master with his stuff.
Wow. Good grief.
Isn't that great?
I mean, it is great. I mean, that's what the deal is with this, is that 4 years ago, I was telling Chris, you know, if something happens to me, she's going to have to put all this stuff individually on eBay or do something.
Right, right.
And we suddenly went, you know, we can't do that, especially not with a lot of the collection we have. This was the other Ico that I thought was good that they made. This was an amplifier I built way back when.
Wow, I've never even seen one of those.
That's when we pursued the museum and started a nonprofit, and we're 4 years into it, but pretty disappointed in the lack of support, I suppose, from the lot of engineering things.
Yeah, the recording industry is kind of funny that way.
Yeah, I mean, people are all excited about the performers, and you can get all kinds of support for that. Have you seen a wire recorder?
I have not.
This is so funny. Chris is really amazed because that's the wire. And it's just amazing.
That was in good shape.
It is.
I've got to stop. Can't risk going back to your jail. You put that gun away, damn savage. Pop your fool head off.
Pretty good quality.
Yeah.
Come on inside.
All right. I love the metering too, because the metering has the. Is this the bulb? You can just see it coming on that. Well, like you said, I need to clean my pots. This was the first Ampex that came out and met the same specs as the 200, the big one over there, but in a portable case. So this was by 1956. So that was 47. The 300 is like 48 or something, and then this was 56. But this is the one that has no tape lifters.
So it's always...
It's never been conventional politics, as far as I can imagine it never will be, unless I change, but I've pretty much been this way since I was about 10. And it's pretty much a real passion for me. And it's always taken precedence over music, which is the fourth category. And people have never understood that, and there's a lot of people have resented it. You know, she's a singer, why doesn't she have to sing that, but she does best. And then I think I felt the pressures of a crumbling world around me too strongly to just take off and have more of a fun singing.
That means the head's cleaned. I've lost the high end on it.
Sounds pretty good.
Thank you. This is, you know, the MCI, which I'm sure you've seen these guys. Maybe that's all. I just love the way they did this.
Oh, yeah, that's the machines that, Chris Morrow.
Yeah.
He turns them vertical for, you know, for home use. Or...
Yeah.
And what model is that?
It's MCI JH110.
Okay. Wow, they're a beast. They're a good size machine.
Yeah. This is the last thing that Sony made in analog, reel-to-reel. And this guy just functions wonderfully. I don't have this through the amp. I'm going to get out of it. This Logic thing is just gorgeous. The way it hands, it's got a ceramic and a capstan. Yeah, I love these guys. And so that's the last thing Sony made. We've got an earlier Sony down there. We've run a lot of our sound through these little TIAC Model 1s, which is really helpful because you can spread about four things all the way around the room. And then the Ampex 102.
Oh, yeah, legendary. They had two. So they had two of these up at Rocky Mountain Audio Fest.
Yeah.
And the gentleman that owns Sonoma headphones was like, hey, listen to this DSD Digital. I go, whoa, hold on. What's that? He goes, that's an ATR. I go, well, hook me up with that. And he played it, and it was just...
Really, oh, God, these are really... Yeah, I don't have this all linked in right now, but I think the interesting thing about this guy is that, again, it's just really smooth as can be as far as running.
Oh, wow.
It's running at 30 IPS now, which is fast.
Oh, yeah.
We're probably going to look for another amp to put in that thing if we can find one. So after all of that, and what was this? 23,000. This guy was 12,000. Then these guys, two guys in the East Coast, built this guy, which was Tape Sonic. It was called the Poor Man's Ampex, $675, and it was a workhorse. It was really good. These are really cold right now. I'm surprised that started up that quick, but they're really cold. But they were called Premier Electronics, and it was two guys that hand-built them, and I found one of them was still alive, and I contacted him and left phone messages and told him we'd really like to do an interview, but he never got back to me. So the rest of it's upstairs.
All right, let's go up there.
I have always...